Hello explorers and welcome to another video. Today I'm gonna talk a little bit about Java and compiling in Java. So how the Java VM and the Java compiler works and when does the actual compilation take place. So in Java you can either have interpreted code, and that's when you read in the code and you interpret it. And you might think that it's interpreting the actual code that you are writing, but that's not the case. You will run the compiler on your Java code and that will create some Java bytecode that then is interpreted. And this is not optimized in the best way. It's just and representation that is easier and faster to read than the code you are writing. And then if you run things a lot of times, it will do a just-in-time compilation of that Java byte code to increase the performance of the code. And that's done by default if the function is run more than 1500 times. And if you want to speed this up even more and have more performance in the beginning, there is in Java 9 a new tooling that makes it possible for you to compile your code ahead of time. And that's another thing that we will look at today. So first off, my little program here that we are going to run a lot of times. You have this found primes. I will try to find 10 primes. And this little function here is checking if it's actually a prime. And this will be run a lot of times, so that we want that to be as efficient as possible and probably want that to be compiled. And then we have this little find prime function. It starts at 500 and finds primes above 500. So that's just that. If you are looking for really low-numbered primes, that goes really fast. So I thought if I put it a little bit up in the range, it might take a little bit more time. So I will go through and look if this is a prime, then I will check the next one and the next one until I find a prime, and then I will put that prime into my array. And the next time I run this, I will look for the next prime. And my main function is just creating this class in the beginning, going through all the primes, and I will type out which call was run and which iteration, and then I will start the clock and get the nano time, and I will find the prime and get the end time, and then I will type out how long elapsed between the start and the end, so we get some timing of how fast it actually ran, so we can see the difference between the different compiling. And if we look at my little readme here, I have typed down what we are trying to do today. So first off, we will just compile it and run it and see what we get for the result there. And then we will run this little command, and you have xbatch here. This is actually telling the Java just-in-time compiler to, when it encounters something that needs to be compiled, it will stop the execution, do the full compilation, and then start the execution again. And then we have this print compilation command here, and that's pretty self-explanatory. It will actually print what was done during the compilation. And if we do this, we will get a lot of output. We will see that later. So I have added a few more commands here. We have this print, I'm double clicking, this compile command file, so this hotspots compiler file, and that's just to say what things to ignore so we don't get so much output from all the Java standard library things that will be compiled. So things we will ignore here, we say that we want it to be quiet and exclude Java, JDK and Sun packages, all classes, all methods. And then we have this compile threshold. So if you are running your program and you have more than 1500 iterations, then it will start to pre-compile, and we want to do that earlier, so that I just set the compile threshold of 5. So if a function runs more than 5 times, it will be pre-compiled, so the just-in-time compiler will run, so it will run earlier. And we also need to set this tiered compilation and remove that feature, because if we don't do that, it will actually not do the compilation in this process, so we might miss the compilation. So we need to remove that feature as well. So this command will actually give us how it looks when we are pre-compiling stuff. This command down here we will not run. It's if you want to see the compiled code that actually will be run. So you will print the assembled code. Why am I double clicking? You will print the assembled code down here. Then if you want to do that, you actually need to also type in this unlock diagnostic VM options in order to do this diagnostic output. And I have not installed this disassembler in my environment, so I can't do this output. But if you find the library that is needed, it will actually tell you what library it is, and you are interested in looking at the assembled code, you can run this command and get the assembled code printed out. And next up, we will try to create an ahead of time compilation. So we will create this little test lib here and do that on our test class. So this JOTC, so Java ahead of time compilation command will output this SO file and compile the class. And then we run this by saying where our ahead of time library is located on disk. And we will also print out the ahead of time steps, so we know when it ran the ahead of time tests. And I will also try to run it without this, so we can see the difference in time from the different functions. And a good thing to note here is that if you change your class, so if you recompile your class with a different value in the class, this AOT library will not run, or at least that function that you changed will not run, because they create a hash of the function they have compiled, and if that hash does not match the earlier function that they pre-compiled, they will just run the new code instead. So that could be good to note, that if you want to use ahead of time compilation, you need to do it every time you recompile your function. And I will jump into my little Ubuntu box here, because ahead of time compilation is only supported on Linux and Mac platforms at the moment. There is no Windows binary for that, so we can't run the example there. So let's just compile our little test Java here, so we get a new file and run test. So we see here that it took some time to run the different steps. From the call one, we got 4000 millis, and then it went down to 1800, and then 800 on the fourth, and then up again to larger numbers. So it takes a while for it to actually find these numbers. And if we try to do this batch thing here, we we'll see that we get a lot of output, as we talked about earlier. So all these Java classes are compiled, and we're not really interested in that. So by changing it up, and adding this little hotspots compiler, we will remove all that output. There we go. So now we got a lot less output. It's still a few things that are compiled, some native things, but it's much less of it. And if we then look at changing it up, so it will do this compile after 5 instead of 1500, and we run that, put that in, we can see here that it does a batch compile somewhere up here, and we see that it elapsed 10,000 nanos, and then here we see that it takes a lot of time the next call, and then it's really fast in the next coming up after that. So if we remove this little print here, we can actually see that it takes a lot of time in the second iteration, because that's when the actual big batch compilation occurs, and then we have a lot faster execution times after that. And we don't do this assembly print, so we will do the just in ahead of time compilation now. So we compile it, and this takes some time. I've done it before, so it goes pretty fast, but it can take some time to actually create this package. And if we run this, we see that it runs the ahead of time up here. So it found this library, it loads it, and it loads in these functions. And you see that the running times are really low from the start. It's much faster than this just-in-time example here. And it's even faster than the one we had above. So we can run just a test here. You see that the first iteration was 4,000 and 1,900. So all these numbers are higher than these numbers here when we do the ahead of time compilation. If you are running things that will do a lot of iterations, or if you have a function that does a lot of work that could really benefit from being compiled ahead of time, this could be a good method to use. I hope that you found this little trick interesting. I'm really interested in that it actually is a new feature in Java 9. Little sad that they haven't implemented it for all platforms yet, but I guess it will trickle out during the year, hopefully. So we will get this ahead of time compilation on all platforms. I understand that it can be a bit tricky to get it working well. I run a lot of my code on Linux at the moment, so I can probably use this and benefit from it today. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comment section below. I hope you like this episode. If you liked it, share it with your friends and colleagues, and subscribe if you haven't done that, and I really hope to see you in the next episode.